Hi, my name is Max Lee. I'm the author of the Paul Redux blog, here with Klyne Snodgrass, the Brandel Professor of New Testament Studies, to interview him on the occasion of his 70th birthday, as well as receiving a festschrift from family, friends, and colleagues alike. Klyne, my first question to you is, how did it feel to receive such an honor?
I thought you were going to ask, how does it feel to be 70?
Max, as you know, they announced the festschrift last May at graduation and took me totally by surprise. Other colleagues here have gotten festschrifting, but I did not have this on my radar screen at all. And to have that kind of gift from your friends and colleagues, former students, is something unparalleled. It's deeply gratifying. And there are not words that do justice to the significance of the book. And what's really, I think, really satisfying for me is, one, the title of the book, Doing Theology for the Church, because that's what, one, I've tried to do here, and two, what our symposium tries to do each year. So in many ways, this is a symbol of not just my work, but also the work of the school. And you look at the number of our former students in it, or our colleagues here, like yourself, and you said, this is something very good. And so I'm very thankful.
Klyne, speaking of doing theology for the church, how does one do theology for the church? Whether you're in the library, reading and researching, or in the classroom, forming the next generation of Christian leaders, what kind of scholar and teacher have you tried to be?
Over the years, two of the things that have really become very important for me is, one, the language of a hermeneutics of obedience. That, you know, we come with the anticipation that we are going to obey God, regardless of how we get led in that, but we are going to obey. And the other is a hermeneutics of identity, something that I did not know early on in my career was the focus of my career. And it's only in the last 10, 15 years that that has kind of taken center stage, so that to do theology for the church is a way of keeping asking ourselves, what is it that this text is shaping us into? What is it that this text is telling us about our relation with God, and how we are to live our lives in relation to God? As you know, North Park has long had a focus on spiritual formation, and that's only another aspect of doing theology for the church. So that would be at least an initial way to start responding to your question. I think, first of all, I have to say that I did not choose to be a scholar. When I took faith much more seriously than I had anticipated, I was led down an academic path, really not knowing what was down that path. I did not have a good understanding when I was young about what an academic career meant, and certainly never planned on teaching in a seminary. I do my scholarly work because it was the call of God on my life. And what that means for me is that it's never merely academic work, it's life work. And so for me to deal with a topic, whether it's Paul and the law, or parables, or my own identity, or something else, it's really a question of who am I, and how do I live this life that God has given, and what does the text keep trying to tell us about who we are and what we should be doing?
Klyne, it's rare that one scholar stays at an institution for so long, and yet you've spent 40 years and counting at North Park Theological Seminary, and served as a scholar for the Evangelical Covenant Church. And so I wanted to ask you, what legacy, and what challenge do you hope to leave us as you entered retirement coming this spring, 2015?
What legacy? I felt like starting out that one of the things that I thought we all needed was a stronger exegetical tradition for preaching. And I've always had a goal to enable people to handle the Word of God well and proclaim it well. I don't know whether I've been successful over the years or not, but I do know, at least with certain people, they got it, they understood. I don't know anything more important for us to do in a seminary than that. It has to be about the centrality of Scripture and what Scripture is doing. Especially when we seem to be moving in a time where, one, the church has less influence and people have less understanding of Scripture, sure, less care about Scripture. So what do we do to bring people back into focus and help them to see what the text is doing and how it is the foundation for life? And I consider it a privilege to have been engaged in the task.
Klyne, might I also ask, what has been the greatest joy for you in your vocation, and also perhaps the greatest struggle?
The joy is easy to talk about. I'll never forget my first year here when it came graduation time and I realized that a number of my friends were going to be leaving. The joy is the relationships that you establish with students and colleagues over the years. And now literally we have friends scattered all over the world, and to be able to watch them do significant work, to see the ministries they're engaged in, I mean, what greater joy and pleasure is there than that you see people living really productive lives? You would not look at the task itself as a struggle. Work, yes, but not a struggle. If you know anybody working in a seminary, it works pretty hard, but I've never had the feeling, oh, I have to go to work. You know, you wanted to be here. You wanted to be engaged with the life of the community and with students. And so the struggle was when things don't go the way that you would want them to. But I feel like I have been so privileged to do what I do. And I mean that sincerely. Our former colleague Bob Hubbard and I used to meet each other in the hall and laugh, and one of us would say to the other, they pay us to do this because we were going to do it anyway.
Klyne, I've mentioned retirement a couple of times, but somehow I think you're going to be very active in your next chapter in life. And I was wondering what your immediate and long-term plans might be, both vocationally and personally.
Max, 15 years ago, we knew what we were going to do, and now we don't have a clue.
That's a relief to hear, actually.
Maybe for you, but not me. But we don't know whether we will stay in the Chicago area or move near our family, either in Tennessee or North Carolina. With regard to projects and activity, I fully plan to stay engaged and active. I am sure I'll be teaching in some context sometime. In terms of projects, I have a manuscript on identity that I hope to finish, and then I have a few other things that have been put in front of me. One is to do a commentary on Galatians, which I am thinking seriously about doing. One is to do a smaller book on parables, which again I'm thinking seriously of doing. And then another project pretty close to my heart is what I call the gospel of participation, which I think is the language we should be using to talk about the gospel in the church. People have some thought that if they just think the right things about God, that's what Christianity is about. But no, you read the text and it's about participating in life with God. And I'm thinking seriously about trying to write a book dealing with the gospel of participation. It would be fun to do.
That's fantastic. Yeah. I think you'll need another career to do all that.
You're right.
For this last question, I simply wanted to give you an opportunity to share some last words, words of appreciation, especially to your family, as they shared the longest part of your journey and vocation.
You make me think about the circumstance when my daughter was about 6 years old. We were going to spend the summer in Seattle. I was going to be interim pastor in a church there. I think my daughter was six, and we were actually recording her voice as we used to do. And in the conversation with her, we talked about going to Seattle, and I said, why are we going to Seattle? And she said, we preach. And in some sense, my family has always been accompanying me in the task, especially my wife, Phyllis. If she had not done what she did, even when I was in seminary, we would have not have been able to go to doctoral studies, I'm quite sure. Now, if she had not been willing to deal with a lot of shortage, we would not have been able to do what we do. She's actually the one that was the moving factor in the decision to come to North Park, and been terribly supportive the whole way. And the kids have accompanied me on the journey, and they're still very much a part of that journey. So all that's to say, across the board, in terms of colleagues, friends, family, and tasks, I'm a very blessed man, and I thank God for it.
Well, that concludes our video interview with Klyne Snodgrass, the Brandel Professor of New Testament Studies at North Park Theological Seminary. Thank you, all viewers, for tuning in, and I think all of us would like to wish you again our congratulations on the reception of your festschrift and blessings in your continuing work for the church.
Thanks, Thank you, Max.